evening.
With where I wanted to go. In our culture, we don't use the word wisdom. It doesn't mean anything. We can't operate with it. We're not familiar with it. But to put in front of the idea wisdom and immanent wisdom means that that wisdom must be in something and it's going to be in us. That even makes it more perplexing. But we're saying there's an immanent wisdom of the dream master. We've talked about dreams and we've worked the idea of a master. We want to put them all together now. Would like to explore a couple of ideas now in terms of dreams. But first, before I do so, I would like to know from those that have contributed dreams in the past what they found later reflecting on their dreams. Juan?
I found it a little peculiar that I kept ignoring that one side.
The right side.
The left side.
Yeah.
I was focusing on the right and I ignored the left.
Mm-hmm.
And I kept thinking about it and reflecting upon what could it be? And finally I looked at the right side and looked at what that would mean in the chain, and I looked at both sides because both the trigrams were right there. And it fit perfectly.
Mm-hmm. Look here. Let's take a look at this. What is it that a dream does? We're saying the following, are we not? That the dream master, whatever it is that's responsible for our dreams, selects from our past, draws materials, it's always particular to us, it's always our personal history. So it selects from not just a public past, but our personal, private past. It presents it in the present to us. The question we have is, does it open up? Does it illuminate the present? Dream does something else. It focuses on its issues, not ours. This is really quite interesting. I'm sure you've enjoyed it as much as I have, because I have been in situations where I thought, here are all the difficulties I'm having, here clearly are all the problems, I can rank them, I can list them all. And so I have a dream and I get a dream and I look at the dream, I explore the dream, it brings up an issue I never thought of. It's not on my list. It has its own issues. They're not ours. Yet they're ours. So it selects from our personal past, brings us in the present, forces us to focus on its issues in a very dramatic way. It then develops certain themes in the dream, which we then follow. In some cases, we follow one theme through several dreams. Therefore, it presents us the mystery. Now, what is this mystery? Let me give you the mystery as I see it. Suppose you were going to decide just for a certain period of time in your life, as a trial, that you would make your issues and your concern its issues, the issues it illuminates in your dreams. Suppose you decided to make that your primary concern and all of those priorities where you put all of your problems and tasks and works, you put its issues on top of it. And you decide to make that your paramount concern. Well, that's really strange. That's reorganizing your life on dreams. But it will be on issues that are not those that you focus on yourself. So it presents the mystery.
That's exactly what happened with the dream of exploring.
No.
Yeah, there were a couple of developments in the dynamics where you say state of mind and dream. We call it a bond, and there was this other kind of a desire to go thing. When I left here, I thought, oh, I know what that applies to, and I kind of applied it to the priorities of my life. But since then, they haven't quite fit, so I've become more interested in this states of mind that I have, you know, what I usually put as a priority. In other words, I'm looking at how I do other things in terms of the states of mind, so it's become a priority.
And that presents an interesting mystery.
It is.
And the mystery is, and you can see it, and you can only see it if you take dreams in sequence. You can only see the next step if you take dreams in sequence. Have to take dreams in sequence. See, it's one thing to say the dream master is puzzling out our present. After all, that means the present is close to us in time. It can use the past to illuminate it, but it's focusing on the present. What happens when we say dreams are in a sequence? They're linked together. They're linked together over time. I have taken certain issues that have come up in dreams, and I have a portfolio of them. And I have certain themes that have played themselves out for years and years and years. Now, when you see that, you have to say that the Dream Master is focusing on issues over a long period of time, and the whole issue is it for your benefit? That's the only real issue. After you work it through and after you come up with some explanation and some understanding of it, the big question is, and the only thing that makes any sense, is it a good? Now, when you study dreams of other people, as I do, have done, then you see something quite remarkable. Each individual can see for themselves that opens up an area that they have ignored that's significant to them. The good, therefore, is individual. There's an individuation of goodness in dreams and in sequences for the individual. So that the particular good that's being sought in one person is not the same good as found in another, though they all may fit under the general category of goods. Therefore, there's something in the Dream Master that's particularly attentive to you and your individuation. It's not a generalized good. It's as if everyone has their own way to climb up a mountain. Surely the goal is the mountaintop, the summit, but everyone has their own trail that forge ahead and discover all the way up as it goes. So that what you see in sequence is the individuation of goodness. That's quite remarkable. It's not impersonal. It doesn't deal in general with drives. It doesn't deal with instincts. It deals with you and your own particular good. Your own particular goodness it seeks to unfold. Now let's look at something else. If that's the case, what does that do? What does that present you with? I think it presents you with, if you go through this in this way, with the following. You're involved, therefore, when you're in dream analysis, as we've been playing now for several weeks, There comes a point where the issue itself draws you. You want to see it. So there begins to be a constant reflection on the issues unfolded in the dream. Now here's something curious. When you're working on a dream, you're turning to the dream. You're focusing on the dream. Look here. Look what this means. And here you are. All right. And now you have to pull together the dream out of its various parts. You have to link them together. You have to link them together. You have to preserve their integrity. So you have to restore its unity. You're focusing on the dream. You're returning to the source. You're returning to the source of the dream. You're returning to the source of the artwork of the master. You're engaged in it. What you're trying to do then is, now here's something rather curious. As you're doing this, you're restoring its unity. You are focusing your mind on the area of the dream or the dream content, but you're focusing your mind back on the dream, trying to recall the dream. Is it not true that every time you do that and reflect on the dream, you come up with additional pieces that you hadn't expected to find? You add to it. It opens. What does it mean? It means that you, when you reflect on the dream, you focus on the area of the dream and recover a new content. It's as if, even though you're not in the dream and you thought you understood it and you had all the pieces, by reflecting on it, you're, as it were, focusing on it, and then you discover pieces you hadn't even realized were in it and yet are contributory to its meaning and therefore important. That's reflecting a reversion on the origin of the dream. As you're doing that, you're going through several interesting processes we can talk about. If as you're focusing on the dream and you get these additional pieces and you begin to see the theme emerge, you begin to see the theme emerge, then you're reflecting on the process, because as this theme emerges, it has a goal, and the goal always is in the dream to open the meaning of the present. Right? To open up the meaning for you, to show you the meaning. So what we're doing now is we're adding something to dream analysis. We want to see whether we can understand the very process of the dream construction. We want to see whether we can get an insight into whatever it is that's doing the dreaming. What is it that's doing the dreaming? What produces it? We also want to see whether we can reflect on the dream itself. Now, as we're reflecting on this process, and we're beginning to see that we're open to meaning, that means if it's in sequence, that meaning emerges. The meaning itself emerges. Not only did the theme emerge, but a meaning emerges. That means it's capable of greater and greater degrees of perfection. It means it's an artwork. It's a crafting on the level of meaning. Look here. For a theme to emerge out of these works, and for the theme, therefore, to emerge over a series of dreams, to be open to that meaning and to see a meaning emerge over a period of time, which you can do, that means there's something that's maintaining something that is emerging. It's presenting for you something to reflect on, which if you can then grasp, it becomes a way to understand your present. Now I want to use a word to represent that. That's the idea of to measure. Because if you have something you can use to understand something with, that's a measure. And therefore, dreams in sequence, where a meaning emerges, you can see therefore that the dream master, or what's doing the dreaming for you, or creating the dream, is maintaining that measure over time. It maintains it. There's something intelligible. It maintains it. To the degree that this is a significant issue that emerges, which you hadn't anticipated, then not only does it maintain that measure over time, it preserves it or conserves the perfecting. It means there's something in there that is directed, that is concerned, that's carrying the theme from series to series. Therefore, there's something in the dream master that conserves the perfecting process of series of dreams, linking them together. Wow. Remember we said, as you said a short while ago,
sir,
Bill, you said that as you saw the focus of the dream and you saw the issue that came up, you then were able to say that's significant. Wait a minute. The more you say it's significant, the more you say you hadn't anticipated, the more it's capable of showing you a part of yourself that you hadn't anticipated, the more you now have to make a curious judgment. How significant is that dream? How significant is the issue it brings up? To the degree that it is more significant than the list of things you thought were important, therefore it means dreams are grounded on the superior. It's grounded on things more superior than you have been able to consider, that you have been able to discover. Then there is something in the dream master that reflects on the process. The process over time is a perfecting process. It maintains a certain standard, what we're calling the measure. It conserves the perfecting, since the perfecting goes on in each dream. The perfecting goes on in each dream. Therefore, it carries that theme consistently over a long period of time. And therefore, it draws you, here's the nice part, it draws you to consider that the issues and the themes presented are superior to those that you have identified in your own life. Therefore, it has a grasp of what's inferior and superior, and it presents the superior. Now, what do we mean by the turning about? Yes?
I'm sorry, but on that, so are you saying there's no inferior dreams?
There are no
inferior dreams?
There are none. Worse than that. There are no themes that are presented in dreams that stand to your goals as an inferior to a superior. No. It reveals a part that you you have overlooked or hadn't studied or forgot a certain aspect of it. It raises a whole issue blind. And the important thing, you see, is to see whether or not this is true. And as you do this, the more you can see that it is presenting you something that is superior to what you formerly thought was superior and significant to you, to that degree the dream master is able to show the superior and direct your attention to it. Now, if this takes place, the degree to which it takes place, there's a turning about. Naturally, turning about, and your attention now becomes, what is it that is directing its efforts to my perfection, consistently presenting again and again and again, each night, never tires, those themes that are most significant to me and working on my behalf. You finally have to turn it around and say, what is the dream master? You now have to come to grips with it. Have to. What happens when you do that? Without the dream, without working on dreams, without being working on dreams, then you're alone with your problems. You're only able to identify a certain set. You're able to identify a set and a higher set you're going to be ignorant of. As you focus on dreams, the present changes, because now with reflections on those issues presented by the dreams, you are now focusing on a higher set of problems, and you're now able to see the insight, the precision, the beauty of the dream master being able to present to you the things that are part of you and your unknown past in a rich and a new way. Now we come to the dream master. What does that mean? What does it mean? Let's see whether we can build it. Does it not mean that your present, as you view your present, you're able to identify a certain set of concerns? When you're asleep and you're dreaming, the dream master, is able to be aware of this set and finds another set more significant. Let us call these A, B, and C. A, B, and C have links with your past. They are, if they are presented and successfully perceived, it not only links with your past, but shows a way of your own development. Now, that means when you are aware today of your life, you can see a whole set of concerns. You're easily able to identify them. We can list them here, whatever they are. You can talk about them. The dream master is going to focus on another set. Therefore, you either, when you go to sleep, pass that information on a platter to the dream master, or the dream master is awake in your waking world. There is something in you that's aware of your present, sees what you're ignoring, and it's essentially ignoring. It's not a good and bad game. Then can take these elements that you've ignored, contrast them with what's going on in your present, use your past to illuminate the fact that they are tied together in meaningful wholes, and present you in a very dramatic and simple form in the dream, and highlight the issues that you've ignored. That's the dream master. So I submit the following for you. That means there is something awake in our waking world that we are asleep to, that we ignore, that we don't recognize. In our dream world, we are presented with the show of the dream, but equally we're ignorant of the dream master. The dream master is not seen. It's not seen. But yet, from this, clearly the dream master must be awake to our lives, our goals, our past. Yes?
Therefore, if the dream master is aware of what's in our present, it shows us what we are ignoring. But yet we can't see it. And are you saying in this whole process it's trying to show itself?
Yes. By reflecting on it, though we don't experience it directly, we can learn about the dream master.
It's trying to show.
That's right. That's what we're doing.
Show what we're ignoring.
We're looking at the footsteps or the footprints of the dream master, as it were. That's right. Now look, that means then, right now, there is something masterful that sees, that is always seeing, that sees your present, is concerned for the issues in your life, can present them in this way, and specifically for you to achieve your own particular goodness. I mean, it means that right now, it's awake to what you're doing. If you're being here and you have a particularly interesting problem, let's assume you do, and for one reason or the other, you only see a part of it, which is why it's a problem. If you saw all of it, it wouldn't be a problem. So right now, there's something puzzled about you being here, let us say. You're not clear about that. It's only natural. That means then you're aware of a certain part of the process. The dream master is aware of the entire, knows the particular problem you're having now is identical in form to something that you faced in your past again and again. It's going to take that material and give it to you tonight. If, and to the degree to which, any particular issue emerges tonight that's significant. Let's see if we can add to it so we can get it even more significant. Because the degree to which you can appreciate and understand the dream master, your dreams are going to change. Is that a curious hypothesis? The degree to which you're knowledgeable about the dream master means then that your dreams are going to change in a very interesting and creative way. But look here. So right now there is something that is seeing. And you can't see it. There's something that's aware of every conflict you have right now, can rank them in a hierarchy, is going to use those that are most significant right now for your present, is going to then create a drama for you, pulling out of your past all of the significant features that are allied to that, so it can create for you a present dealing with your past so that you can see it in the evening, at night. Now, you can't see it, therefore, you are going to develop a growing awareness of the dream master, yet it's without a second. You're not able to perceive that there's something within you that is doing all this seeing. Yet without being aware of the second, the seeing, right? Without a second, yet it's present before the seeing. What does that mean? That means you're not aware of it, yet it's there, yet it's present before the very act of seeing that takes place in the dream.
Self like the self. Same thing you can say about the self. Or mind.
Use the higher self with a capital S, yes, or M, the capital mind. Yeah.
When you say before, does that mean prior in time or before?
It's prior to the seeing. The dream master is there prior to the seeing. It's always there. It's prior to any particular seeing. It never turns off.
Oh, okay.
The because it never turns off. We don't need to rename it.
You don't need to rename it?
Yeah, shouldn't we rename it if it never turns off?
Okay.
It's not only a dream master, it's a wake master, it's a spiritual master. Because in other words, it's not something that's just functioning in and through our dreams.
No, but does it function totally through a dream that gives it a special character and quality? Because it doesn't function that way during your waking world.
What about vision? When you have a vision?
That takes place. That takes place.
Like you know that's happened before.
Yeah, that takes place, but it doesn't open up anything particularly meaningful, right? It just gives you the recognition that there's something significant happening. Right. Quite true. Well, look. Let me see if I can now add to it. As you focus on it, let us assume, as we said before, that you're now focusing on the dream, the work of the dream, you're inquiring about the dream master. To the degree then that you focus on its issues and you learn the themes that it's presenting and the way in which it is functioning, would you not agree what you're beginning to do then? It's consider that what it is presenting to you has a higher priority than you previously had given it. It also, the themes it presents, you're beginning to see, may have a higher priority than the ideas you thought were significant. Would you agree as this process goes on, you're now going to focus more on the Dream Master and the fact that it's presenting things of great significance to you? Then your concerns are the same as the Dream Master. You're learning to understand the Dream Master through the dreams, and to that degree you're learning its language, you're learning the way in which it communicates, you're now being able to focus in a similar way on the things it considers significant. Therefore, would you not agree you're being driven to a To the degree to which this goes on then, its concerns become more primary. You're drawn towards them. You recognize it's opening up areas that formerly were blocked to you. You're seeing that in a sequence, there's something within you that is vastly intelligible, intelligent, and that is focusing for your particular good. Watch what we said. To the degree then that you're focusing on these concerns, you're now beginning to consider these as more primary. You're then learning the language and how to understand it. You're seeing an analogy between the dream and your life, because that's what understanding is. So you're focusing on the tool of analogy. So you're learning the language. You're learning how to set up analogies in your thinking and be able to see how your past relates to the present. You're able to focus more on its primary concerns that formerly were blocked for you. Put it together. You are becoming more like the Dream Master. Therefore, there's a turning about, and you're becoming more like the Dream Master, even though you never made the statement that you were going to be like the Dream Master. You're becoming more like the Dream Master. learning the language, learning how it functions, learning. Matter of fact, you should be able to create a dream you never had.
Right? Yeah.
You should be able to create a dream you never had. Under one condition, right? That to the degree to which this process goes on, you'll be able to see certain themes become apparent. You'll be now aware of the fact that certain things you've overlooked, and it's adding new pieces to the things you've overlooked. And therefore, you should be able to create a dream, even though you never had it.
In the other sense of the word dream, like a vision?
Yeah, yeah. And you're creating? A
personal dream.
A personal dream. Ah. That's called speculation on dreams. Or through a dream. So you're becoming more like the dream master than you're becoming in that degree, seeing like the dream master, learning the language, thinking like the dream master. You're becoming, therefore,
like a dream master.
Except your dreams are occurring in the physical plane, in the social arena, whereas the dream master's creative message is occurring within your psyche.
Of course, that's right.
Say more. Although it's harmonizing the
Yeah. Okay, now, let's see whether we can now give it something. Let's give it something to do. You can give it something to do. You can ask for it once you play this game. You can give it a problem. You can give it your problem. It's aware of your problem. You can give your understanding of your problem. To the degree that you're willing to do that, it will give you back your problem as it understands it, since that's what it does all the time. Right? Nothing new. What is it doing? You can concern yourself about your life, areas of your concern. You can dwell on it, reflect upon it, and you can offer it to the dream master to create a dream to explore. That is to say, now, you can enter into a kind of dialogue. Curious kind of dialogue. That means there's something you're doing, you're turning about and treating yourself on the highest level in the dream world. Let's see if we can go another step now. I think we're clear on this. Okay, here's where you go. You first have to create the dialogue with yourself. You first have to create the dialogue with yourself. You have to tell yourself, as you understand your problems or the issues that you're facing, you have to talk to yourself about it. An active inner interior dialogue. You have to fill it with intensity because it's your life. And therefore, you can therefore through this highlight it. The degree to which you highlight it and show a concern for it, it's going to become part of things in your life that are important to you without any manipulation, naturally. Since it's going to be a concern in your life, your dream master is going to deal with it naturally, and you know it will, and therefore an interior dialogue sets up the condition for highlighting what you think is significant in your life, and your dream is going to pick that up and it's going to tell you whether you're right or wrong. Better than that, it's going to point out where you're off. What does it presuppose? An interior dialogue. Now, how do you get it? You already have the material for it. Take whatever, let us assume now, that this is a dream, this is a dream, and this is a dream. Through it, you can recognize themes. You can see there are certain images that are highlighted that reappear in a variety of ways. So you can see connecting themes between dreams. Now, you can do two things. You can talk to someone else about these. You can talk to someone else about them. You can discuss them. And after such a discussion, could you not then turn and talk to yourself about it yourself, since you've already done this homework? Just as you were talking about it a short while ago, and you mentioned it before, would you not agree you were reflecting upon it yourself? What would happen if you treat it systematically as a dialogue? What's the difference? What would you be doing?
Well, you was talking and discussing it with yourself without this idea of systematic, what you're saying is that it comes up when you're walking along, or you're driving along, or something like that. When you say systematic, you would sit down. That's like you would sit on a pillow in a Zen center. You would sit down to do it, and you would attempt to stay on it. You'd ask questions about it, so I don't know how much further I can say about it. That's what it means when you say systematic to
me. But you're giving it intention.
That's right. Well, giving it
attention.
Rather than
you're
just
giving it concern. You're giving it concern. It becomes an object of contemplation.
And you're acknowledging its importance.
You're acknowledging its importance.
So if it is going to come out for you, it's more likely to come out if you recognize to acknowledge its divinity.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then you're working, then you're a co-worker with the Dream Master. You're a co-worker with the Dream Master. Look, you're a co-worker, aren't you? You're understanding it, you're working along with it, you're talking about it, you're reflecting on it, meditating on it. You're a co-worker in the process. So therefore, through this, you become a co-partner in your own development. That means likeness becomes more heightened. When likeness becomes more heightened, right, that's a conversion. That's a conversion. That's a turning about. That's a conversion. That's a perfecting. That's being guided, and taking a role in the guidance.
Being concerned about the concerned one.
You're being concerned about the concerned one. Therefore, you are now entering in as a co-partner. It's no longer something that's happening to you. You're not passive. Therefore, to the degree then that this goes on, this term highlights. This highlights. And would you not agree, what is being highlighted is the thing you are becoming like, is the Dream Master. So therefore, it becomes the model. You become the copy. There's a perfecting going on through likeness, and you're becoming closer and closer to the model, the Dream Master, through the process of likeness.
So by the act of seeking the model, you're bringing up those virtues within yourself that are the model's most perfect
quality. Yes.
So Telemachy, it's a
Telemachy.
By seeking the Father,
he becomes like the Father.
He becomes like
Yeah. That's a kind of development, isn't it? Now notice what has to be here. What has to be here is that you have to find the good. You have to find that it's a good. You have to find that it's a good for you. Right? You have to find this. You have to find it. You have to recognize it. And you have to then name it. Say it. Because without that recognition, without putting the name on it, that means an unwillingness to admit something very significant.
That's what I want to understand. What is that unwillingness?
Well, do you have a dream?
No.
We could take a look at it. Because that has a, see? You see, that's a theme, isn't it? Obviously, that is a concern to the gentleman, isn't it? Obviously, right? Is it not likely, from what we've been saying, that dream is that issue, that theme is going to show itself up in a dream? We would expect it. Without having to force it, though, right, we'd have to sit back and look at it.
It shows itself up in a refusal to take the dream, a fear, a shame, a guilt, some state of mind that I don't want. The less said about that, the better. It is a vivid dream, and I go back to sleep and forget.
Yes. The feelings you're having are correct, the assignment is wrong. The feelings are always right, the assignment is always wrong. Yes. See, it's a major principle in all reflection and dream work. Look, here you are, and you're saying you recognize something. You recognize the act of recording. Puts you in a certain state.
Yeah.
Could you describe it?
Scared.
More.
Guilty. Shame.
Guilty. Look here. Guilty.
Shame.
Shame?
Yeah.
More.
This is going to reveal something about me which I don't think I would want to know about.
Reveal
a deep
dark
sin.
Terrible.
Yeah, unbearable.
Unbearable. And you're not going to be able to be strong enough to endure it.
No, even with Prozac.
Right. The feelings are right, the assignment is wrong.
Oh, you think they might be my mother's?
These feelings are what happens when you decide to make this kind of a decision. Say, what would it mean for you to make that kind of a decision? What would it mean? What do you consider that?
In light of what's been said here, it really profoundly says, I think the Dream Master is connected. If that is not God, it's connected to God, who has an idea of caring that's beyond anything I'm quite aware of now. And I have a smaller idea of caring. And that I think that I'm, by not reporting it, I am losing. I'm stepping out of my own.
Yes. I'm losing the higher.
Yeah, I'm losing my angel.
Right. You're losing your angel. You're losing the higher principle.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let me ask you the question
again. By recording it, I'm taking the courage to step into that higher realm.
Ah. By recording it, then, you are then saying something. What would you be saying? So you put it negatively before, I'm losing the higher. Can you put it positively?
By recording it, I would acknowledge that there is a higher...
I would have to acknowledge there is a higher...
Yes, and that it cares about me.
And it cares.
And that I know that it cares.
And I know it cares. See, this is a view about reality.
Yeah.
This is a view about the nature of reality. And to accept it and act on it generates this state, doesn't it?
Yeah.
How important would that mean that you are to act on it, to acknowledge there is a higher something and eminently cares, and you know it cares.
It would be not counted. I mean, well, I think it would. At that stage, I use theological language.
Yeah, that's right.
It would be that there's like some kind of divine entity out there that loves me enough.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not using the Platonic word.
Yeah.
But, cares and loves. And,
yeah.
But I'm here for some reason.
Mm-hmm.
And, the universe considers it important enough to talk to
you. Mm-hmm. And the reason you're here?
Don't know yet.
Well, I'm sure you do, from what we're doing. Your own individual good is the preeminent concern of yourself, your
yes.
higher self.
Yeah, my highest good.
Yeah.
My divine good.
Yeah. Okay. There you are in the morning. So the dream came on. He has to reach over there and turn the switch, and this state comes in.
Mm-hmm.
The state is true, that the assignment is wrong.
What do you mean by this?
Okay. There is someone in your past circumstances that have produced a view of reality for you, and that's here. It's in marked contrast to this one.
Yeah.
Want to give some details?
Oh, sure. I know about Dharma. There is no. If there were a God in the universe that cared, if there were such a God, it would explain the Holocaust.
The misery.
Misery.
The pain. The suffering.
My great grandmother's name is Leiter. It's German for to suffer. Leiter, suffer.
Look, having this view of reality is a way of crafting a person. Crafting them. It makes something of a person. It gives them a certain identity, a way of relating. That's what they crafted. Whoever crafts your vision of reality is crafting you.
Yeah.
Now, therefore, in general, see whether or not we can push this. Look here, in general then, whenever you're challenging this most fundamentally, as you did early in your life, they had to do something to preserve this. Because without this, they would lose their image of themselves. How do these fit? These feelings are true.
Seems like my mother was always showing those feelings. I was always embarrassing her. But, you know, she was always pinching me under the table when we shot, and that's crying.
When you were doing what?
Saying what I felt.
When you were revealing something about yourself.
Yeah, or about the family.
Or about the family. Look here. Then this comes up when you are, right? When you reveal something personal, important, about yourself or the family.
Right.
Is that right?
Yeah.
And now if you have this dream, what do you think may emerge? It's going to be something... something personal about
right.
yourself and your family
yeah.
and your teaching.
Yeah.
And this is what... Come on. This is... Come on. This is...
My mother's face is good.
When you
sitting around the table talking with my aunt or in public, out, you know, revealing, just talking, and all of a sudden I get a kick in the shin. Do that.
So look here. by turning on that switch, you're challenging her, this whole view of reality, just by turning that switch.
My father played into it.
With this, I can even put a father.
It's funny. It's like I remember 12 years ago, just an adult scene, my father brought his girlfriend over to meet me. This was when I come back from Arizona. And his girlfriend said, you know, Sydney told me that I should take what you say with a grain of salt because you just say the craziest things. He said, nothing you said was crazy. I think you're interesting. And I go, oh. But he was afraid. It was the same thing. He was afraid that what I would say is what he was on.
And your whole vision of reality should be taken with a grain of salt.
Yeah.
Huh. Yeah. And now it's your motion to turn on that machine in the morning. And you're facing there, what? What do I call it?
Their nihilism?
Their nihilism. But you accepted their nihilism, you grew up in their family. Right. And the whole problem in life is, what is it going to do just to opt for this? Not as a formal belief. We're not talking about changing beliefs. We're not talking about any kind of change of belief. We're not talking about any instruction. All we're talking about is what would happen if you turn on the machine, decide to take your dream seriously. That's all. There's no belief involved. No one's asking anybody to change their beliefs. Just to do what? Hey, do you want to see whether you can pay attention to your dreams?
Yeah.
And everything else follows, doesn't it?
Yeah. I mean, that's my study.
No, you see, the feelings are true.
Okay.
But you assign it to the fear of opening up this state.
Which is what I wanted to do.
Yeah, but you think you're going to have to face this in opening up this dream.
Mm-hmm.
No. No. That's their reaction to your turning on the machine.
Mm-hmm.
It's not yours. You've assigned it to the dread that you may encounter when you listen to what you're putting on the machine.
Yeah.
You are assigning it to the event of turning the machine on and the consequences of it. You are going to feel guilty, shame, da-da-da-da-da-da-da. In one sense, it's true, for leaving the family belief. For in that act, you're making a decisive psychic act of great significance. Just so the feelings are true, but not the way you assign them. And there's a great struggle, isn't it? Nihilism, that's a family tradition.
Right.
Whole view of the nature of reality. Whole view that since nobody cares, you can do anything you want with reality.
Thank you, that's exactly right.
Huh?
Offspring don't matter.
Nothing matters.
Nothing matters.
Nihilism, nothing matters. That's right. Therefore, no one is responsible for anything, and you can get what you can get, and you can forget any values, since values don't exist. Yeah. And all of that can change by turning on a machine and seeing whether or not dreams are meaningful.
But it's like I know it's that nihilism, and I'm afraid to see. It's like, okay, I'll still use the language. I can use it myself right now. I feel this fear.
Yes, but pardon me. You do feel the fear.
Okay, there's an experience of terror.
Yes, terror.
I'm seeing nihilism in my own life. It's kind of like, oh my God. You know what? It's like,
no, of course.
That's what it feels like. It
feels like
I'm going to go to hell.
Yeah, of course. Of course, you've been a student of nihilism. Therefore, you're going to be a nihilist until you find a way out of it.
Yeah.
But the point is that there's something that's helping you to get out of it. or you wouldn't be here.
I've been looking to get out of here this
yeah.
45 years.
Well, you bought the machine. It's an act. It's a decisive act.
This is one of those cases where the problem has handmade a problem.
Yeah. Fuck yeah.
We all go here.
Yeah. So, and each day he doesn't turn on the machine, you're agreeing to stay in the family. You're agreeing to preserve the teachings of the family. Oh, of course. Minor prize.
This constant be a
destiny. Okay, now we're going to go back.
Easy for you to say, prize.
No. So it's a... So this is a non-belief structure. It's non-belief. You either discover this or you don't discover. It's not an exchange of one set of beliefs for another set of beliefs.
It seems to me that it does require a kind of a leap of faith. Because at some point I've got to say, I believe that what I'm going to get by putting on this recording is better than what I'm going to get by denying or not listening to myself. You
know,
I have to have this confidence.
No.
To do it. No.
No. No confidence. You don't need confidence. They would need confidence to change. You don't. We have to just turn the knob.
Why would they need confidence?
Because you know if they were going to change, they would need all the things they think were important to bring about changes. None of which is true. All you want to do is see what you get when you get a dream. You know the implications of it. You know how it will be treated by people like this. You know what that's going to do. Now they're going to take your whole life with a pound of salt. So, we're left to make a decision. See, there's something that's really marvelous about all of this. See? Okay. You see, that the whole discussion about what is there about the nature of reality that makes it spiritual? Only one thing. You have to have a basis for saying that it's good. The nature of reality is good, has integrity. If that's not present, it's not a spiritual universe.
Sure.
No, there can be plenty of growth, there can be plenty of development, but unless that piece is there...
How can there be growth and development if there's no good? I mean, in any meaningful sense.
A person can overcome any number of problems, and to that degree, to live more successfully, have a greater degree of integrity, but still think they live in an uncaring universe. And therefore they can change accordingly. But they're not getting into the most significant change. Well, the most significant change is, what are you going to call the Dream Master? And what's the significance? All right, go the next step now, back to two more steps. What's the significance? Let me ask you, since you're carrying the discussion for a while. What does it mean for you to say there's a Dream Master? What does it do to you when you say it, since you know the position now and you can talk about it?
Well, one thing, it seems corny.
It is very corny.
Okay, and I can see where that there's a kind of a... But what's on the deepest level for me, what it does is it it makes me feel like there is a caring entity. I call it an angel. I like that term. There's a daemon or an angel. There's something that cares about caring. And not at a superficial level, but at a level that goes beyond lives and goes beyond a lot of stuff. And seems to have all the intelligence.
What follows when we, you, put into words what you're now seeing about the Dream Master?
I'm filled with love. But also I'm filled with regret. I regret that I feel like I've stayed away too long. I feel a lot of things. I won't try to judge him right now. I'll just tell you what the feelings are. But what happens is a lot of feelings. I've been away too long. I've done damage. There's a higher intelligence in this universe, and it's not just a computer-like intelligence. It's a higher intelligence that has something good. It's good. That has to be there if there's a Dream Master. For me, I mean, it will lead me right to that. Because what does it take for something to do what the Dream Master does? What must the Dream Master have going for itself in order to pull this one off? And why? That's the other one. Ask why. It must have great benevolence.
By putting it into words now, what you're saying is not only this, but you now want to see what kind of universe is this in which a Dream Master functions the way in which it does.
Yes.
Right? What kind of universe am I in? If the Dream Master is such as we're describing. Yeah, that's right. What kind of universe is it? The Dream Master exists. But you know what? Isn't it interesting that every single person has a Dream Master? It's not just for people in Brooklyn.
Individual Dream
Master? Pardon?
Individual Dream Master?
Well, a Dream Master. Individual concern for each individual. Everywhere. Over time. I don't know what it means to say you have a Dream Master. Do you mean it that way? You have a Dream Master? Or are you saying it's difficult to say that each person has their own Dream Master?
I thought that's what you were saying.
No, that's worth saying. See, that's one of the things you have to now say. And that's the very issue we're on, which is this a particular Dream Master for each particular person? Or, go ahead.
Or one.
Or a one.
For all.
For all. For each. Huh?
Well, basically you have to ask the same kinds of questions you do about a whole level, any being. Or any form, what's called idea. In that, is there one idea or many, how is it distributed? You have to bring out that whole business of participation. You have to clarify that.
Okay. That's right. You have to clarify it. Once you talk about the existence of the Dream Master, now you're entering into an interesting world, a world of thought, of logos, where you now have to ask, wait a minute, is this a particular, does it live and die with me? Does, what kind of existence does it have if it's one for each? How does this fit in with any kind of intelligence in the universe? What rank does it have? How significant is it? Let's add a religious element now. All right?
If it's,
will it bind you to a group? That's a religious element. Religion means to bind, religio, right? To bind together. Or does it have a spiritual basis? They're different.
Can religio have a higher sense of binding you to a cosmos?
No. Not in the sense.
Okay,
religio
means... You mean a social group?
Well, yes.
Okay.
Religio means a belief that binds people together.
Okay.
Which then makes them members and lets others be excluded.
No, it doesn't.
All right. Does this have a spiritual dimension? Whatever the word spiritual means in the Dream Master, at least we can agree with one thing. Is it possible for the Dream Master to present someone with a total vision of the nature of reality and a full, meaningful enlightenment experience?
Can people have an enlightenment experience in dream?
That's right. On a very, and on a, since they admit enlightenment experiences, as you know, admit of a certain range and degrees from the oxidating pictures and other things, on the most profound level, not on the lower levels, if you can rank enlightenment experiences, and if dreams are capable of offering those to us, do they appear on the upper end or the lower end? What would follow if they appear throughout?
Have you ever had dreams? I think people have. I've had dreams where I felt super awake. It didn't feel, it had a different quality. I mean, it felt super real. I mean, far more real than anything in my waking life. I've had a couple of those dreams in my life.
Yeah.
I'd say in that arena, the enlightenment was, it was a higher order of reality.
If we could say then that it offers this range of experience, the spiritual dimension, now we then have to talk about the Dream Master, do we not? And say, what is the upper reach of the Dream Master? You'd say the upper reach includes the full range of enlightenment experiences. Now, wait a minute. Look here. Does that mean, let us go one more step. Would you agree when you're talking about enlightenment experiences, that means necessarily you are going beyond the personal, beyond the boundary of the personal? Does it? By necessity, does it not? Therefore, the Dream Master cannot be particular, but it is one for each, offering the highest to each that it's capable of receiving. Therefore, the degree you are receptive to the highest range of experience, it matches it with its own likeness. It matches it with its own likeness means then that the Dream Master must be able to access this range, and therefore it both transcends the personal and yet is yet imminent, since it can then disclose it to those to whom it finds able to receive it. If so, then it is an immanent wisdom with a transforming direction, operates on a particular level to help us understand the areas of our life which we're ignorant of. It ties together our lives ties together experiences in our lives. It has themes it presents to us over time. It continually can be engaged in the perfection of man and maintains that perfection, can turn man about, can convert him, and therefore it can function on the highest level. And all of those terms are the major and key terms of metaphysics. Therefore, the doorway into the most interesting metaphysics is through the doorway of dreams. You're forced to consider these questions, are you not? Because they're important to you. It's your experience. It's not theoretical as if, but it's as real and personally significant too. Therefore, dreams open up in a very real way the upper range of human experience and the highest level of our reflections, and therefore it causes us to revert on our existence. See, it causes us to revert on our existence and take it seriously, yet playfully. Since I assure you, there are some dreams you can have that are so funny you wake up laughing. And I've had them. So, let me take a break for a moment and ask you, is that a hand? No. So,
in terms of the idea of the dialogue, it's funny. I mean, I've tried having, going to sleep and asking questions and trying to engage the reader. And anticipating what he's going to do. Because I think there's a certain problem that I have that needs to be worked on. And what it comes up with is rather funny because it's sometimes a problem.
It's what? I didn't hear
that. It's not what I wanted to look at or something else.
That's right. Absolutely.
In that sense, it's crazy. That kind of playfulness or punishment aspect of it. He's not working this step. He's trying to control it.
Pardon?
Right. Not right either. I try that. I promise.
The idea of likeness then is principle for this, because as you get into it, you're drawn to it, and the very things we're exploring makes you much more, as you become more involved in it, closer to it. Therefore, the likeness between you and the dream master becomes more and more approximate. It brings, therefore, a communion with it, and you then become, in a sense, bound to it without shackles. So, therefore, we can say bound loosely more in the sense of joined with it in a meaningful exploration where you and your existence is the very subject. And therefore you are part and parcel of a vast reality, as profound as can be, that runs through it a caring spirit that has an immanent and innate wisdom which it unfolds to you. And all you have to do is become receptive to it by learning its language, becoming involved in it, which is nothing else than learning yourself.
Suggests that we have a unique responsibility in respect to our waking world. Because the dream master can't just materialize in front of me, my waking, and give me a Dharma talk and straight, or reach into my soul and brain and change things. It's up to me to mediate.
So if it did any of those things, it wouldn't care. Because anytime something goes into you to change you, it doesn't care.
It's not dialoguing with you.
It's not dialoguing. It's not a growth. It's not you that is emerging. So I'm going to get a cup of tea for a minute. I'm running out of fluids at the moment. So let's come back and have a cup of further talk. Yes. But what is man then? If this process goes on, we become more like the Dream Master.
Well, I think a way that I ask that question is, what is man if the Dream Master doesn't intrude on our ignorance? I mean, doesn't intrude. I mean, it gives us an opportunity with enough work. We really have to pass through an initiation to get to the Dream Master. We have to know rationality. We already have to understand analogy. You have to understand a lot.
No.
To get to the point where we can dialogue with the Dream Master.
But you don't have to learn analogy. That's natural to man.
Yeah, it's natural.
Natural.
But but it's interesting that there's these divine forces in the universe that don't change us from outside.
Mm-hmm.
They give us an opportunity for our own internal nature to choose and to change. That's an interesting view. Yeah. I mean, what is man such that it's worthy of that much respect?
That's right. It's not imposing.
Yeah.
See, it's not imposing. It's emerging.
Yeah, it's an emergent.
See, the Judeo-Christian system is imposing. This is an emergent wisdom. Joining, co-sponsor, co-partner.
It's like a lot of dream interpretations are imposing. They have a theory which can be there and impose it on
them. That's right.
A lot of books out of that say that.
Yeah.
Here's the system.
Yeah.
Find a symbol of this better system.
Mm-hmm.
We've got the glossary and this way to dream.
Nearly all dream work in the modern world rests upon one word, which maybe sometime we can talk about, and it's this word.
Compensation?
Compensatory. It's a compensatory function. Nearly all psychology, be a psychologist, they have to use that word. Have you heard about that word? By heavens, I'm talking to someone who is well read in these things. But you do know that word? Well, that's right. All dreams serve a compensatory function. Not a creative function. Right? Merely compensates for imbalances in the life of the individual. Right? Compensates. Pardon?
I said, what is satisfied here is taken care of in the dreams.
That's right.
Satisfied in the dreams.
That's right.
But what do they mean? Because you can't have it in your real world, or it will be there in your dreams.
Yes.
Yeah.
Compensate.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Whatever pressures exist in your home life, and all of the negativities that result from it, whatever pressures they are, your dream then will compensate for it and allow you to appear more triumphant in respect to that, or show you that aspect of that imposition in the strongest and richest images and language. So it's compensating. Right. Hi.
So why would you not remember your dreams?
Oh, that's normal. That's normal. That's just a matter of focus. Everyone who's been involved in dream studies has discovered the same thing, which is the more you focus on the need to record your dreams, the more you tell yourself that you're going to record your dreams and remember your dreams, you will. It's a matter of focus. If you make sure you go to bed every night with a tape recorder under your pillow, and pay for it, don't borrow it, invest something in it, right? The more you tell yourself before you go to sleep that you're going to dream, you're going to wake up as soon as you have a dream over a period of time, that's precisely what will happen. And then you'll be, once that happens, then you will want to deal with why you don't pay attention to your dreams and why you forget them. In the, you know, that'll become a theme in the dream. But that's normal. As you probably know, there are many interesting UCLA dream studies where they have people that come in and they wire them in a special way so they can determine whether or not a person has any dreams or not by the way in which the eyes behave, because in a dream you're seeing images and therefore your eye moves even though your eyes are closed, rapid eye movements. So they can put electronic gadgetry on people when they're asleep, and when their eyes move in a certain way, in a certain rhythmical way, they know the person is dreaming. So they had many subjects in the UCLA dream study where the subjects reported they had never dreamt in 10 years or 20 years, etc. And as soon as their rapid eye movements were indicated by this machinery, they'd wake them up and tell them, just talk about anything that's on your mind. And sure enough, what would come out would be dreams. So everybody dreams, is the conclusion. They take place on the average every 90 minutes. You have more than one. When people think they have dreams with different themes in the same dream, it's really different dreams over a period of time, and they link them together in the morning and call them different stages in a dream, or divisions.
So in many of the studies I've read say that REM comes in after some ungodly length of time, 40 minutes, 90 minutes, I'm not sure which. But the dream I had in here, that I explored here, I got the whole dream in 20 minutes, cat nap.
Sure.
So this idea about taking a long time to get a dream,
No, they say that they occur every 90 minutes, within a 90 minute period. Not that you have to wait 90 minutes for it. No. Like if you continue that nap 90 minutes later, you have another one at least. That's a theory.
Yeah, because I've waken, had a dream, taped it, and gone back to sleep and noticed the time, and 20 minutes later have a dream as well.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I'm
sure.
Yeah. And see, wherever there is a study that has empirical data, I pay attention to it, but I'm not bound by it. Right.
Well, other companies are maybe there are dreams that are REM.
Yeah, special dreams, REM dreams. That's right. That's absolutely right. Yeah, could be. Like some people have dreams where it's auditory rather than visual.
But it's an interesting point. I mean, it's just like if whatever it is, it's functioning as a dream master for our well-being.
Mm-hmm.
How can you go 10 years without noticing a dream or writing one down? I mean, in other words, there has to be some kind of orientation. There has to be some kind of orientation occurring in the waking state before this providence can be received through the dreams. And then what causes that orientation?
The best thing to do when you study people is to sit down one afternoon when you have nothing to do and get a nice tablet in front of you and write on the tablet all the things that you think that will never happen with people, to people, among people, around people, all the things you think is so, whatever it is, so absurd, will never occur. Then figure it's taking place somewhere around 50 miles of your home. Including people who say that they've never dreamt in 10 years or 20 years. No. Normal. People are capable and do everything, is the thesis.
They say also those people who are in REM sleep, they're checking out their EEGs and respiration and all that stuff, and then they're in REM sleep. It's as though all they're awake, whereas in the other stages of sleep is a real sleep. So, you're only to look at that and say this person's awake.
Mm-hmm.
A dream. And a dream. Right.
No. You would conclude?
Well, the dream master is always awake.
Always awake.
Oh, that's interesting.
Right, there's some always awake.
That, just if you look at that, but there are people who are deep
sleep. Yeah. People who face emergencies or have to be awake for unusual circumstances often sleep and wake up when there's crises. Spontaneously, just wake. Independent of the hour. There's something awake.
Mm-hmm.
I will wake up at 6:17 in the morning. Wake up at 6:17. Right.
Yeah.
Something's awake to the time. It tells you to wake up at 6:17 in the morning.
I did it for 3 years in the Navy. I decided to get up 15 minutes earlier than everybody else. And I can't even use an alarm.
Yeah.
I got you. Alarm was up. And so I got up every morning for 3 years. Right on time. I got a reputation for it. We go out on the beach together and go to a hotel and somebody say, Bill, wake us up. And I said, what time do you want? And they tell me. I say, what time is it now? They tell me. And then I wake up at the time.
See?
There's 5 minutes
early. Yeah, right.
Yeah, I don't use an alarm.
Pardon?
I says, I don't use an alarm.
Yeah. No. Oh.
I use an alarm. I said, half an hour.
Okay. Thank you for coming.